toys, comics, rumors, Project Luminous, Babu Frick, Wedge Antilles, and what is Kevin Feige really doing with Lucasfilm? So let's dive right into some recent developments on episode 9 because the release date is right around the corner and we all need to be ready for it when it gets here. So recently another fan favorite character is said to sort of officially be making an appearance in The Rise of Skywalker. Now this character has been rumored to be appearing before and I'll come back to that, but what makes this sort of unofficially official now? Well, Rebel Force Radio recently tweeted that they had gotten a solid yes from a representative from Dennis Lawson that he will in fact be appearing in The Rise of Skywalker as Wedge Antilles. But before Rebel Force released this though, Planeta Comique had posted some cover art on Twitter for Resistance Reborn that showed Lawson standing behind Finn, but the post was very suddenly taken down by the account. All that being said though, there hasn't really been any official announcement from Lawson himself or from Lucasfilm that Wedge will be making an appearance in The Rise of Skywalker. So we'll have to just keep our eyes open for his return when we finally see the film. And for those of you that don't know what Resistance Reborn is, it's a book that will come out before The Rise of Skywalker and will have more information on the movie characters and what happened right after the ending of The Last Jedi. The book comes out on November 5th, but Star Wars has released an excerpt from it to give us just a little taste of what's to come. The short excerpt is a scene between Leia and Rey discussing Kylo Ren. They both see the dark and light in him, but haven't been able to get through to him. In the excerpt, Leia says to Rey, "Ben has made his choices. No one can save Ben but himself, and I don't know if that is what he wants." This could be an important lesson for Rey to learn that she cannot save everyone, but could also be a hint for what's to become of Kylo in The Rise of Skywalker, because many believe and have speculated that he may end up redeemed or even having to team up with Rey and the Resistance to fight the dark side. You can read the full excerpt from The Resistance Reborn on StarWars.com. But The Rise of Skywalker is definitely going to be exploring more of Rey and Kylo's relationship. Co-writer of The Rise of Skywalker, Chris Terrio, said that some of the most interesting scenes in The Last Jedi are the conversations between Rey and Ren. We've tried to pick up that complicated relationship that really has been present ever since the interrogation in Episode 7. He also said, when Ren takes off his mask, there's a nakedness about him with Rey that he doesn't express to anyone else. Ryan developed that in fascinating ways, and we've been able to develop it even further. I mean, it's no secret that Rey and Kylo definitely have a unique relationship and connection, so it'll be very cool to see it explained and explored more in depth in the final film, and hopefully their link to each other and the importance of that will also be explained. Something else that will be explained more in The Rise of Skywalker is who exactly the Knights of Ren are. I know you've all heard me say it before, we've been asking this, along with many other things, since The Force Awakens, and we've all eagerly been waiting just to even see them on screen for more than a second. Well, as you are all aware, I'm sure, the Knights of Ren are finally making their long-awaited appearance to the saga in The Rise of Skywalker, and some interesting facts about them have finally come out. Now first, the new Ultimate Star Wars edition shares details about the Knights of Ren. The entry in the book reads, "The Knights of Ren are Kylo Ren's most deadly and mysterious servants. With their bodies encased in rusty, battered armor and their faces permanently concealed beneath ominous masks, echoing that of the new Supreme Leader himself. Even their species remains a mystery. What is obvious to anyone who witnesses them in action is that their fighting skills and martial prowess are without equal. Each knight is armed with a lethally effective and unique weapon suited to either long-range or close-quarter combat." Okay, so a few things to take from that. These guys are so mysterious, we don't even know what species they are, and we most likely won't ever find out. And this could be on purpose. Remember, Boba Fett never removed his helmet on screen, and now look how popular he became. Maybe they're trying to achieve the same level of mystery here. Some fans are even hoping for it, and that we learn almost nothing about the Knights of Ren in the next movie. But another thing to take from this excerpt is that these guys are really good at combat. So good, they are unrivaled in it and are each trained to be experts on certain kinds of combat as shown by the types of weapons they carry. And this is something that probably makes them so strong as a group. And one more thing. When these guys fight, it's probably to be the only ones walking away. The entry says their weapons are lethally effective, so they definitely mean business in combat.
As you wish.
But there is something we could learn about them in The Rise of Skywalker that will take away the mystery. The Knights of Ren do have names. We don't know what they are yet, but we will likely find out soon, but probably after the movie comes out. This was confirmed by Pablo Hidalgo. A fan tweeted at him asking whose idea it was to name each of the Knights of Ren Knight of Ren, since that's how their names appear on toy packaging. Hidalgo replied saying, "They do have individual names, but given the long lead times required for toys, the names weren't finalized in time for that product." So there you have it. The Knights of Ren will never show their faces or anything, but they do have names. So that's cool, I guess. So while we'll probably finally get the answers behind Rey and Kylo Ren's relationship, and possibly some more Ben Solo, and learn just a little bit about the Knights of Ren, there's another thing. Just the tiniest thing that I'm probably the most excited for. The epic final battle. Yes, the ultimate showdown. The end-all, be-all, the ending to the Skywalker saga. So there was this tiny leak or spoiler that came out from Making Star Wars recently that described just how that final battle might look. Now, disclaimer, while this could be a spoiler, you must also take this with a grain of salt. Nothing I'm about to say is officially confirmed. So anyway, the leak says that the grand finale will involve Palpatine. Well, duh, yeah, I could have guessed he might have something to do with it. Anyway, there's two major things that will happen during this. Ben Solo will die, and also that Rey will be able to tap into her powers and invoke Jedi that came before her. Okay, so that would be where all the Force ghosts would come in, like Luke, Obi-Wan, Anakin, maybe Yoda, and so on. So, like, she draws in their power to take on Palpatine? I mean, what was that thing that Snoke said? Something like, the dark rises and so does the light to meet it? So maybe Rey wasn't getting stronger to face off with Kylo Ren, it was to face off with Palpatine this whole time. And in order to ultimately be equal in power to him, she has to call on the past Jedi to help her achieve that. Just a thought.
This is madness!
I mean, this is the ending we really want to see though. Do all of these past Jedi need to come back to end the saga? Let us know your thoughts on this supposed ending in the comments. But there seems to be one thing that we aren't asking. What will we not end up seeing in Episode 9? One thing we maybe weren't expecting or really wanted to actually get out of The Rise of Skywalker was a retcon of The Last Jedi. But recently, J.J. Abrams told Empire magazine he had no intentions of doing that at all. He said, "I never found myself trying to repair anything. If I had done 8, I would have done things differently, just as Ryan would have done things differently if he had done 7. But having worked on television series, I was accustomed to creating stories and characters that then were run by other people. If you're willing to walk away from the thing that you created and you believe is in trustworthy hands, you have to accept that some of the decisions being made are not going to be the same that you would make. If you come back to it, you have to honor what's been done." I mean, that does sound pretty reasonable and responsible, though it may not exactly be what a lot of fans are asking for. It does sound good that JJ has some respect for Rian Johnson and that it is important whether or not you feel the same way. However, just because he isn't trying to repair anything in this film doesn't mean it won't answer any questions or still be any good, and I'm a believer in waiting to see it for myself before forming any opinions about it. Also missing from the buzz about the movie, Rose Tico. But more on that in a moment. So just a couple more things before we move on to other Star Wars news. One important thing, you guys do know what month it is, right? It's October. And you know that The Rise of Skywalker is coming out in December. And if you've been paying attention to anything over the last several years, you know that typically when it's October, it's also football season. And during football season, you have Monday Night Football. And sometimes when there's a new Star Wars movie coming out, Disney likes to release trailers during football games, usually in October before the movie comes out in December. So what does that mean? Are we going to get an official trailer? Huh? One that just isn't a teaser? Are we going to get it soon? Did Disney accidentally potentially reveal the date for said trailer release on Twitter? Maybe. So there was this tweet, right? By the way, you all should really get Twitter if you don't have one. I mean, we are on there, but also it seems like a lot of Star Wars stuff happens on Twitter. Anyway, there was this tweet from DT Vaughn, a Star Wars fan, with a super cute picture of his dog and an equally cute photo of Babu Frick, and he said he was thinking about making his pug puppy a little Babu Frick costume. Now, while it's hard to stop thinking about how absolutely adorable this would be, Star Wars responded saying, 14 out of 10, this pup would make a great droidsmith. Now, first thought, why did they use 1410 specifically? Some are thinking that 1410 is actually a code for an important date, which would be October 14th, and also the night of a Monday Night Football game. Perhaps a hint from Star Wars to be paying attention that day? I guess we will have to just wait and see. I mean, after you finish watching Crumbs, you could just go watch the game and see if anything happens. But trust me, if it does, we'll be all over it. And finally, if you're one of the only people on Earth that doesn't know who Babu Frick is yet, allow me to explain. About a week ago, Star Wars released a new movie still from The Rise of Skywalker that revealed to us the adorableness of the new character, Babu Frick. Now, while Babu is cute as heck, he may have quite an important role in the new movie. Babu is a droidsmith that can reprogram or modify any droid, and security systems are no match for him. So if he can reprogram or modify any droid, could he possibly have something to do with 3PO's glowing red eyes? Or does he have to repair 3PO after his eyes start glowing red and he looks like he's joined the dark side? I have no doubt Babu's appearance in Episode 9 will have something to do with one of our favorite droids. I just hope it's not a short-lived scene though, because this guy is adorable. Also, it's fun to imagine him leading like an army of porgs or something into battle. And yes, I want to take him home with me. So let's talk about something pretty important in the Star Wars world, and that's who's running things. Who's behind the scenes and making all this stuff happen? Now first, there's a comment from Kathleen Kennedy about something we've all heard a lot since Solo bombed at the box office, and that is that Lucasfilm learned that there is such thing as too much Star Wars. This recent comment comes from Empire Magazine's coverage of Episode 9, in which they spoke with Kennedy about the plans for the franchise moving forward, and this is what she had to say. We don't have a crystal ball. We tried to look at Solo and see if we could do two movies a year, and we found, that's not going to work. So we backed off a little. That doesn't mean we don't think about lots of different stories. That's the exciting thing about this universe. But where could some of those stories be coming from other than Jon Favreau, Dave Filoni, and those Game of Thrones guys, David Benioff and D.B. Weiss? Well, enter Kevin Feige, president of Marvel Studios, who is now going to be working with Kennedy on Star Wars going forward. We don't know exactly what extent yet. The early word was that he'd be producing a single film, but there could be more to the story. This could be Disney and Lucasfilm's way of bringing someone in to re-engage Star Wars audiences, considering how morale in the fan base has been recently. His success with Marvel Studios can't be ignored by anyone after Marvel put out hit after hit, as he managed to identify what worked well with the Marvel films to keep that franchise alive and dominating in box offices to the tune of billions of dollars. While under Kennedy's tenure with Lucasfilm, fans have gone back and forth between anticipation and fatigue. One can only wonder if Feige is being brought in to oversee some of the filmmaking processes that will be underway soon after the release of The Rise of Skywalker to perhaps prevent some of that Star Wars fatigue from fans, since he was so good at preventing any sort of Marvel fatigue within that franchise. Particularly with whatever the new Star Wars trilogy will be that's going to come out starting in 2022. This would be a good move for Disney and Lucasfilm to try and bring back some cohesiveness between the films in the next trilogy and even whatever spin-offs they may do in the future. They obviously need some help in that department, and Feige might just be the perfect fit for that role. But he could also be the perfect fit for an even larger role. I mean, we are talking about the president of Marvel Studios here. Is it possible that he could also be taking over Lucasfilm? Well, the latest news on that comes from Making Star Wars, who is reporting that Kathleen Kennedy will in fact be stepping down from Lucasfilm in 2021, and Kevin Feige will replace her. The update from them is that Kennedy will step down after Indiana Jones 5, but will continue to produce films, and Feige will run Lucasfilm, but will have other divisions run by other people. Now, this is interesting. We know that Making Star Wars can be pretty spot on with their reports, so I'm curious to see what plays out now that this is swirling around on the internet. The timing would be right. The Skywalker saga comes to a close, Disney Plus, and all of the current Star Wars projects are well underway, with Feige already in the picture behind the scenes on them. And if he's already going to be heavily involved with the next trilogy, then he's already got his first films as Lucasfilm president pretty much ready to come out, or at least be well into production at that point. The question is, will this be the right move? Many people I know would probably say yes, and would like to see anyone else take the role of president after Kathleen Kennedy, and with what has become of the franchise. But I want to know what you guys think, so let me know down below.
Join me.
Okay, now let's shift gears a little and talk about some of the things that were announced at New York Comic Con. One of the most major for some fans is what was revealed about Project Luminous. Project Luminous will include at least 5 authors: Claudia Gray, Justina Ireland, Daniel Jose Older, Kevin Scott, and Charles Soule. And will not just be limited to books, but expand over different publishing outlets like Disney Press, Del Rey, IDW Publishing, and Marvel Comics. The biggest tease from the panel, though, was this photo shown to the crowd reading. The Force is what gives a Jedi his power. It's an energy field created by all living things. Until Project Luminous 2020. So it seems that Project Luminous is going to be going in a new direction with the power that lies within the Force. Perhaps Luminous will be what happens after the Jedi comes to an end after the rise of Skywalker and a new faction rises. What do you think? But this wasn't the only Star Wars book announced at New York Comic Con. No, there were several others. First, the announcement of that the Rise of Skywalker novelizations, regular and junior versions, will both be released in March. They will be expanded editions to make up for being released months after the film. Rae Carson is the author for the regular novelization and Michael Kogi author for the junior version. Coming next August will be the Clone Wars anthology featuring a short story collection from authors including Lou Anders, Jason Fry, Sarah Beth Durst, Rebecca Roanhorse, and Anne Ursu, just to name a few. And then we have the continuation of Alphabet Squadron. The second book in the trilogy by Alexander Freed will be coming out in June next year. The title is Alphabet Squadron Shadowfall, and will show readers Erica Quell and her crew preparing for battle with Major Soren Kaizi, former leader of the 204th Imperial Fighter Wing, Shadow Wing. Also in June 2020, a new series of Thrawn novels will hit the shelves called the Thrawn Ascendancy Trilogy. Little was announced about the trilogy other than that Timothy Zahn will continue to write his legendary creation. And also, there was some news that Marvel Comics, they teased about the rise of Kylo Ren coming in December and Empire Ascendant, but editor-in-chief of Marvel, C.B. Sapolsky, also revealed that the next era of mainline Star Wars comics will be relaunching with a brand new number one issue releasing in January. The new Star Wars will be set during The Empire Strikes Back, literally opening right when Luke loses his hand and learns the truth about his father. The series will follow Luke, Leia, Chewie, and Lando on their quest to free Han Solo from Jabba the Hutt. This series looks to me like it'll be a pretty good run. But did you think I would talk about New York Comic Con and not mention the Hasbro panel? Y'all know how much I like my toys. I mean, my collectibles. Anyway, turns out Hasbro held back from us on Force Friday and forgot to mention a few things. So at New York Comic Con, they revealed newly sculpted versions of old and new favorites, and most of them will be retail exclusives, so you'll have to shop multiple locations to get all of the new figures. Walmart will have 6-inch figures of a Spirit of Yoda and Return of the Jedi-style Luke Skywalker. Best Buy will carry an A6-inch IG-11 from The Mandalorian. Clone Commander Fox will be at GameStop, but also should appear on most major online toy stores, and Amazon will carry the Chewbacca and C-3PO set. And for the 3¾-inch figures, Ceremonial Luke will be at Walmart. Target will have a Dagobah 3-pack of Luke Yoda and Dagobah Vision Vader. And every outlet will get a Sith Trooper, but Amazon will carry a special version with extra weapons. And to finish up, most retailers will also carry a Jawa, Ceremonial Leia, and a Shadow Trooper. And I don't know about you guys, but I know what I'm getting myself for Christmas this year. Hopefully I can track them all down. Except it may be a challenge to track down anything with Rose Tico. If you haven't noticed, the character is not in the marketing campaign yet. And now we're finding out that the character is being eliminated from a lot of merchandise. Is this because she's not in the movie much? Is it because the character was a little polarizing for fans after The Last Jedi? What fate lies in store for Rose Tico? And so that's all the news and rumor I've got for you today. Thanks for tuning in to Salacious Crumbs once more for the latest on Star Wars. Look for Salacious Crumbs on the 2nd and 4th Monday of every single month. And also, if you want to stay even more up to date and just listen to all of us talk about Star Wars for a while, you can tune in to our new show, The Rancor Pit, the Friday following Crumbs. It's a live show where you can also participate in the chat, so join us Friday for too much coffee and all the Star Wars talk you can handle. You can also find Salacious Crumbs on Facebook and Instagram, and you can also follow Sci-Fi for Me on those as well as Twitter to stay up to date on the latest across the multiverse. Until next time, may the Force be with you.